Good. Your Holiness, you have said that this visit to Taiwan is a religious visit, yet Beijing and others see it differently. The newspaper this morning says that your visit was bound to spell trouble. Do you think your visit will cause trouble?
Usually, wherever I go, the Chinese government usually, I think, look differently. So naturally, now visit here, the Chinese government, the government of the People's Republic of China, of course, because the Tibetan issue is very, very sensitive, so therefore they naturally, I mean, look very seriously. But it's my logic is the long run, the more closer relation with Chinese generally, wherever they live, whether in Taiwan, whether in America, whether in Europe, everywhere, there's a more closer relation with them. Long run, I think in the Chinese, in the People's Republic of China, also I think through their own sort of, Chinese friends, eventually I think they may get the, I think the correct information or correct sort of awareness. Then also you see to us the more closer relation with the Chinese, then you see their awareness about the Tibetan issue become more clearer. So ultimately, the in order to solve the Tibetan problem, the we must find mutually agreeable solution between Tibetan and Chinese. And then also, the in the past, there's some the Chinese, whether they believe or they simply see they create impression that we Tibetan are anti-Chinese. That's not the case. And we are not against China. We are not against Chinese people. We are not against Chinese culture. In fact, we are trying to develop mutual trust. So in that respect, I think it's my visit, in spite of some temporary sort of voice or noise. Long run, I feel it could help.
And your meeting with President Lee Donghui, will that not provoke Beijing and make them even angrier? Because it's not only you that they have a problem with in Beijing, they have a problem with Lee Donghui as well, as we saw last March.
I think before his decision meeting with me, I think he must take all these consideration, I think.
Right. Can you tell us, in the 1980s, the only time I got to visit Tibet, relations between Your Holiness and Beijing seemed better than now? There were at least delegations going back and forth.
Right.
There seemed to be some discussion, at least. But now, what I hear from Beijing is much harsher, much more personally directed at you than it was then. What has happened?
Now, it is very true. In early 80s, there was real hope. Particularly when you see Hu Yanbang visited Lhasa, he publicly admitted their past mistake and publicly apologized. So at that time, there was real sort of hope. Since then, Hu Yanbang himself was disgraced, and also then you see eventually the larger scale of democratic movement, firstly from the student side, then eventually Tiananmen event, which happened. Since then, the Chinese government attitude towards not only Tibet, Tibetan, but also the other, other issues, becoming much harder, and also towards Hong Kong, towards Taiwan, and in fact. Since August 1993, no more contact with the Chinese embassy in New Delhi. But I feel, and also in the meantime, inside Tibet, the situation also has become much, much worse. In some aspect, you see, even some you see, people consider the cultural revolution spirit in certain field, you see, re-emerge. But I feel the Chinese, People's Republic of China of today, compared 20 years ago, much already changed. And also, People's Republic of China, in spite same sort of government, same system, actually is in the process of changing. So I feel only a question of time. And current Chinese government is a policy, even from the I think viewpoint of Chinese own long-term interest, you see, this kind of a policy is won't help to solve this problem. So therefore, Chinese government have to, sooner or later, have to find more constructive policy. This is my fundamental belief. So, and already, you see, some, if you look from various different angles, you see, there are some, you see, signs. Some kind of flexibility. So, so therefore, you see, in spite, you see, this current, sad situation, I feel there's no need to change my position. So my position still is the same. As soon as some positive indication come from Chinese government, I'm ready to discuss with the Chinese government on the basis of my middle approach. I'm not seeking independence. This is very clear. I fully committed about my middle approach. So through middle approach, I'm quite sure the mutually agreeable solution will find so that you see, this not only benefit for us, but also to the long run, to the Chinese also.
Now, Beijing accuses you constantly of being a splittist. You want to split the Chinese nation. You want independence for Tibet.
No. I wish, you see, some more spy or more Chinese, intelligence people, I think, should come to Dharamsala and stay there permanently and check what we are doing, what we are thinking, what we are talking. This is my easy feeling.
And you're not speaking of independence?
No. Of course, historically, you see, Tibet not part of China. That's also, you see, true. And the majority of Tibetan people, not only outside, but even inside, I think they're completely fed up about the Chinese, the Chinese government. So, you see, they really lost, I think, completely their faith. But my thinking is, firstly, the world is changing. Now, smaller nation, such as Tibet, particularly in Tibet's case, landlocked country. So for our own interest, at least in the economy field, if we join with another big nation, we might get greater benefit. With this conviction, I made this proposal, middle of approach. As the Chinese most concern is stability and what's a national, what's called unity. So we are willing. If they provide us genuine self-rule, then we are ready to accept. We will join with them. So this principle, you see, no change. Still, I feel that's the appropriate sort of, you see, path.
Now, recently we have had an explosion in Lhasa. We've also had bombings in Xinjiang, another sensitive area of China. What are the things that are going on in Tibet today that worry you the most?
Now, this is a kind of activities. Although, at least in Tibet, up to now, these explosives used on ornament or object, such houses, things like that, not on human being. But if this tendency goes continuously, then there is every danger, is it, to shift on target on human. On a human being, this will be very, very terrible. So, if you see this situation remain, the current sort of situation, the hardline is thinking, then there is a danger. Although it's my recent, it's a tense statement, 10th March statement, I publicly appeal to Tibetans. It is not our sort of way, you see, to use violence. The ruthless attitude, the other side, you see, they are doing. If we also, you see, follow this violence, then logically, you see, from certain viewpoint, then, you see, we will have less sort of complaint if ourselves, you see, committed in that kind of, you see, what's it, human activities.
Of the conditions in Tibet, what worries you most about what is happening now in Tibet?
Environment, then also the population is a transfer. I think the population transfer, because of the population transfer, the Tibetan cultural heritage is very much is a danger. Now already, those biggest town like Lhasa and Shigatse, the smaller, now is the Tibetan become already minority. Their day-to-day life very much depend on, in day-to-day life, you see, they have to use Chinese language rather than Tibetan. So through that way, their whole, you see, lifestyle now is changing. So the usually I call whether intentionally or unintentionally some kind of cultural genocide is taking place. Now this is, for me, is the most serious matter, because I feel the Tibetan cultural heritage, usually I call Buddhist culture, this culture have, I believe, some potential, you see, to create happier human society, happier family. And so therefore, not only Tibetan, but also the whole, the northern Himalayan range, and also to further north, Mongolia, and also some republic in Russian Federation. And then most important, I think, you see, Tibetan Buddhist culture, you see, can help millions of young Chinese. So therefore, you see, Buddhist culture, I feel, at the moment, facing danger of extinction. Now, I believe it's my sort of immediate sort of task or responsibility to save Tibetan Buddhist culture. Then political status, I do not, you see, consider very, very important. But you see, these ultimately, you see, up to Tibetan people.
One last question. This is your first trip to Chinese soil since the 50s. Just how does it feel, and do you still hope that you will get to Beijing someday?
Definitely. Deep in my mind, I feel this is some kind of, I'll say, the first step, the second step, perhaps Wuxian, the sacred place in China. And then Peking also. That's my feeling. In any way, we have to deal with our Chinese brothers and sisters. That's the only way. And also, as a Buddhist, the China, most populated nation, if that nation, without, I say, the deeper human value, I think that's a big disaster. Not only is it a 1.2 billion of humanity, but also I think it will affect the whole humanity. So China, in any case, the next already is a become important nation. In next century, the first century, China will be very, very important nation. So the big nation with long history, big population, more economic prosperity, more spiritual sort of, with human deeper human values, and that will be, I think, great benefit for mankind as a whole.
Thank you very much.